So David? It's another 3.5 years since I've seen you. You were prepping this movie last time I saw you, and took a little bit of time to get it here.
Yeah.
Does it seem like forever, or does it?
It's always been there. It's strange. You become the prisoner of your own creativity. I mean, I never intended to make a second Mad Max, let alone a fourth one, but you know, the idea came to me. It wouldn't go away. You keep pushing it away. You end up making a movie. You end up realizing you're going to make a movie. I had no idea it would take so long. Every time the planets aligned, something would happen and fall apart. So when I last saw you, had we cast Tom Hardy and Shelley?
I don't think so. I think you, or at least not officially.
I think we're about to, and then we're about to shoot in Australia in the outback,
mm-hmm.
and in Broken Hill where we shot the other movies, and it rained for the first time in 15 years, and what was flat red wasteland was now a flower garden, and the great salt lakes in the center of Australia had pelicans and frogs in them. It was so to Warner's, to the great credit, said, well, wait, because the locals said we'll dry out and it'll all go away. We waited about another year. Everyone stood down, and it didn't dry up, so we had to move from the East Coast of Australia, like take 200 vehicles and all our equipment and all of our crew and go to the West Coast of Africa, Namibia, where it never rains.
So how long had you conceived that this movie was actually going to exist? How long ago
did the idea first hit idea came last millennium, 1999. And we were about to shoot in 2001 with Mel. And then with 9/11, the American dollar collapsed against the Australian dollar, the budget ballooned out.
Mm.
And before we could even have a hope of regrouping, we'd already had committed to do Happy Feet because all the facility had to be put together to do the animation. And that took, 3.5 years. Mm. And then, the saga went on. And for some reason, it just kept on coming back, and we... So here we are, having finished.
So you were 40 the last time you did one of these. 30 years ago. It's now 30 years.
Yeah, it was more than 30 years ago.
Well, I guess you made it more than 30.
Yeah, it was... Oh, yeah, we made...
It came out in 85, didn't it?
Yeah, 85, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Exactly. Oh, boy. You're better at maths than me.
So you were a 40-year-old guy when that happened.
Yeah.
And now you're fabulously a 70-year-old guy.
Yeah, just now.
Just recently.
Yeah.
So, I mean, do you change in that process, or are you still the 40-year-old guy who made the last one?
Well, part of me is still the kid who grew up, in the imaginative life. So that never goes. But I would hope I've changed. I know that cinema has changed. I know that we speed read movies now compared to 40 years ago. That Road Warrior had 1,200 shots. This has 2,700 shots. And the average, I got the statistics, the average blockbuster is between 2,000 and 3,000 shots.
Mm-hmm.
So, like someone told me the other day, that the first Jurassic Park had no more than 950 shots, I think, all up. So things have changed, the technology's changed. But in many ways, it's also the same. Going back, this was an opportunity to go back and do something kind of old school, with practical effects.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a green screen movie at all. We don't defy the laws of physics. There are no flying human beings or anything like that. So, real people, real vehicles, real desert for 130 days.
And, do you like the size? Do you like the things that have changed and improved over the last 30 years in terms of actually making a movie?
Yeah, yeah. When we did Road Warrior, it took a week to see our dailies. We had to go to the big city and come back again. Now you see them instantly, and you see every camera. You can see. We had lots of cameras. Johnny Seal, who did the cinematography, is not afraid to put up multiple cameras and light for it. So that's a big thing. And the other big thing is... safety. you can erase cables and harnesses and rigs that mm-hmm. you couldn't in the past. So when you see Max hanging upside down, that's, you know, between the wheels of a big war rig hurtling through the wasteland, that's Tom Hardy. Mm-hmm. But the cables that keep him from falling to the ground, we erased. That you could do that a lot. You can erase the tracks. You always used to watch movies when I was younger and see how many takes they did by the skid marks on the road. And you can erase that now. And you can put cameras anywhere. We had a thing called the edge arm. I don't know if you know what it is, but it's a four-wheel drive with a crane on it and a kind of a three-headed beast driving it, a great stunt driver, a grip basically toggle switching the crane and a camera operator manipulating the camera mm-hmm. and me, the director, sitting in the fourth seat with a screen. And that camera could go anywhere. It could go, you know, inches off the ground, underneath the wheels, up through into the cabin of the vehicle. So the film is enhanced. The kinetics of the movie are enhanced enormously by that. And for me, it was like sitting in a kind of real-life video game. So you couldn't do that in the past. You could approximate a shot like that, but not with the facility that you could here now.
So did it raise the bar for you in terms of what you wanted as you were shooting?
Yeah, definitely. Digitally, you have to. Yeah, you have. You could do that. And you could, you know, I mean, without going into such a long story, but, you know, if you wanted to do like an explosion, you wanted to do it at slow motion, like high speed camera, mm-hmm. you get the biggest magazine you could on your Panaflex camera. Someone would have to start the camera, wait for it to get up to speed, and then get out of there mm-hmm. before you had the explosion. You only had a couple of minutes. Mm-hmm. Now you've got cameras you can run for 40 minutes and turn them on, and you don't have to worry. That's a big safety concern, and you can do it much more freely than you could in the past. So the movies better be better, mm-hmm. you know, because you had much better tools.
So what is it like emotionally for you when you come up with a gag, or you're in shooting a gag at a film like this, where it's so complicated, there's so many pieces to the puzzle, but you know how cool it is? I mean, in the end, I guess it's still, do you get off on that? Is that part, are you still that boy? Giggling at it?
Is it? No, it's a little bit more reserved, unfortunately, than that. But there is a certain pleasure in being able to film things which are very, very kinetic. When I first started in film, and I learnt basically by watching movies, and I went first back to the silent movies, and Buster Keaton, Harold Lloyd, the Max Sennett, the two real westerns. I read that Kevin Brownlow book, The Parade's Gone By, mm-hmm. and that's where the film language was forged, and that's what differentiated cinema from theatre. And so The Chase was a kind of pure film syntax, and I became fascinated with that. And my first feature film was Mad Max, and mm-hmm. to be able to do that was very interesting. That boy who wants to, that only happens when we finally get it in the cutting room and it works in the cutting room. Mm-hmm. Because when you're on the set, there are two things. One is you have to be in a neutral place to judge anything. If you're too high or euphoric, you're not judging something properly. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know how people could possibly have made movies with cocaine in the 70s because everything was good.
Yeah.
But that's number one.
Particularly, we've seen some of those movies.
Yeah, and particularly performance.
Yeah.
And then if you're down, you know, if it works, you hit, oh, that was good. Mm-hmm. The big problem doing movies is you can't savor the moment. In an animation, you can mm-hmm. because there's not the pressure of time, but here you now have to move on to the next one. So it's only, and then you get into the cutting room and you've got this massive amount of footage and you say, no, are the bits going to fit together like a massive Rubik cube? And then one day those little bits of material come together like notes and music, and it's really elegant, and you say, ah, yeah, that's when you get that moment.
So I gather there's a lot more film than, or whatever, digital film.
Yeah.
Than we see on the ultimate product.
There's not a lot more story. In fact, we lost very few scenes. We shot, because we had cameras, those big battles were staged, you know, virtually real, excuse mm-hmm. me. And I'll just take a drink.
Yeah,
if you
know. Drink.
Hmm?
Drink. Be well.
Yeah, thank you. Those big battles were staged sort of for real. We had endless landscape. And we'd do that. And every vehicle, sometimes up to 50 or 60, had a camera somewhere. And the big war rig had a camera somewhere. And then we had that edge arm thing, and we had everything else going for us. And each camera you could run for 40 minutes, and it cost you nothing. So we amassed 480 hours of footage, which is 3 weeks continuous watching without sleep. God. And Margaret Sixel, the editor, who happened also to be my life's partner, she had to cut it. She was back in Australia to find the bits. There weren't many scenes that we lost. Mm. They weren't complete sequences. They were parts of scenes and things like that. But just to sift through the footage was a massive thing. And then to find the correct moments. And a lot of times I couldn't even be there with the actors. I was in a vehicle, another vehicle, mm-hmm. and, you know, shouting above the noise. And we had a thing with the actors because, you know, not like long after you say action, you're yelling cut. It's all a mosaic that you build up. Mm-hmm. So we do a thing where we reset. You know, someone would yell reset and they just repeat the take without any notes. Mm-hmm. And we keep driving and repeat the take and repeat. And maybe if we could get up to 5 or 6 or 7 takes, and then we'd have to look at it in the editing room. I would watch it on monitors, but, you know, to select the material. So that was quite arduous, but you know, that's how you make those movies.
Did you change much in post in terms of story or moments, or did it really, was it pretty much what you shot?
We couldn't, because everything is so heavily choreographed that you couldn't change mm-hmm. a sequence of events. I'm sure there are things we changed, and we were able to manipulate performances. You could comp out one of the things in CG. If you liked one particular performance of one actor mm-hmm. and you wanted something else from the other actor, you could select that and actually comp it in, mm-hmm. providing the cameras were roughly aligned. There was a little bit of that. But the whole film was storyboarded. It was conceived as a storyboard.
Mm-hmm.
3,500 panels around a room with three storyboard artists. Brendan McCarthy is a great artist, and Peter Pound and Mark Sexton. And that was the first iteration of the movie after we laid out the story just in notes.
Mm-hmm.
And then we created a screenplay, an illustrated screenplay for that. And if you took, you know, because it's more or less in real time, it happens over 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
If you took something out, suddenly a character would disappear and you just couldn't do it. So that was a bit nerve-wracking because you had to get every note pretty right, or well enough so that you could have a coherence. Mm-hmm. A little bit like music. If a note was slightly off, you know, we hear it.
So was the, in the series of the movies, so as you go to the movies, I mean, Max goes mad in the first one. The second, World Warrior, he's a road warrior. The leap from Thunderdome, there are people who actually said that Thunderdome was kind of not in the series anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
But is that real? Or it's because it seems to me like Thunderdome doesn't, there's no reason to take it out of the linear story.
Well, they were all different movies. Yeah. I mean, I never intended there to be, you know, had we sat down and written a trilogy, that it probably would have been different. But each one was an opportunity to try something else. And Thunderdome was a PG-13 movie. It was a different movie. This film, in my mind, is after Thunderdome, but the chronology doesn't quite work. Mm. I basically say it all happens next Wednesday when all the bad things we read in the news come to pass, and something we never saw coming, and we jump 45 years into the after the apocalypse, a forward into the past, as it were. We now have a much more medieval dispensation going on. The rules are simple, and many people have pointed out they're like Westerns on wheels, in the same sense that the Westerns were allegorical, so these stories are.
Mm-hmm.
And it's less about speculating what the future is going to be, but more about looking at what the sort of things we repeat right through history. That's very seductive for a filmmaker, because you can take an apparently simple story and you can load it with a lot of subtext. So, on the run, as it were.
Well, what really struck me was going back to Thunderdome and the Peter Pan elements of that. And then you go to this film, and there's the senior elements of this,
yeah,
which really haven't been as apparent in the other films.
Yeah.
But it seems intentional, as now are a senior yourself.
Well, that could be part of it. The initial premise of the story was to take do the continuous action thing,
mm-hmm,
and then that the MacGuffin should be human, rather than oil or a thing, as in most movies. So there were five wives, the only characters healthy enough to give heirs to the warlord. Mm-hmm. So it was a human cargo. It started with that idea, and then you had Furiosa, the warrior taking him across the wasteland. Couldn't be a male,
mm-hmm,
so she had to be a warrior, and there was Max. And most of the story happens between them. Without giving too much away, we go to the she's in search of the tribe, the many mothers, and she finds the remnants. And 15, 20 years after she was taken as a child, she actually says at one point 7,000 days. I did the maths, mm-hmm, but I don't know what that is. So that came naturally out of that. But there's it just occurred to me not long ago that because people always ask, how can you do Happy Feats and those sort of things and then go straight into a Mad Max? Well, I realized that when I made the first Mad Maxes, I had no kids, and you'll probably find this. and then suddenly with kids, you're seeing lots of family movies. So your mind is primed for that. So you read a book, Babe, and you say, oh, there's a hero myth that disguised as a children's story. So you try making those sort of that movie and so on. And then the Happy Feet, when my dear friend Andrew Lesney, who just died, came back from the first Lord of the Rings, and he showed me the first Gollum motion capture. I thought, you can make those penguins dance. So you're making those movies. And then my kids have grown up now, so I can go back to that world. It's what's in your life, I guess. Yeah.
Well, I kind of love the idea that you have, seniors, older people, gray-haired women,
yeah,
out there fighting. And it's almost, the film is so topical considering that it's been sitting around, the idea has been sitting for a while, but the movement right now with women has become very hot again, yeah, as a big issue, and older women, and it's kind of seems to be very much of the moment, even though it took 15 years to happen.
It just goes to show that these some things are constant in our society. There's always the struggle of the matriarchy and the patriarchy. There's there's always young men willing to die for old men. The war boys were based on the kamikaze, who, if they die gloriously in battle, ascended to some warrior paradise. They call themselves kamikaze war boys. That's been always in history, one form or the other. There's always been the tyrant sitting on top of the dominance hierarchy, controlling all the resources. And you could argue even today that's the case. So that's what I mean by the temptation to go back into these stories as allegories, because they're pretty timeless tropes that we're dealing with here, all through history. And all through mythology,
yeah.
So it's And so, somehow it does feel more timely in a strange way, particularly the female warriors, and that's. I don't know. Maybe we were lucky that it took so long to make the movie.
And how are you? I mean, are you? You've now been doing this for a long time. You're a grown man. Are you enjoying the? Are you feeling the accolades yet about this movie? Because people are very excited about it. Those who've seen it.
I only finished about 12 days ago. We finished the stereo conversion, and I saw the completed version, not stereo. 3D version with an audience for the first time about 6 days ago, and that was really wonderful too, because they were so, they were so vocal. There was cheering and clapping and picking up so many things that I never thought they would pick up. In the first pass, so that was a really good feeling. And I'm hardwired for this now. It's something that I've been doing all my life, living in my imagination. And I always say to people, if I'm one of those people who end up in a nursing home unable to speak, you can guarantee I'm playing some movie in my head, because that's all I can do.
Do you look back much, or do you think about the past?
When I see my children grow up and my mother getting old, she's well into her 90s and things, and you do. And when you lose friends, you do that. But in terms of looking back at my past, that's gone. I don't go back and watch any of the movies. I watched Road Warrior for the first time at South by Southwest a few weeks ago. Warner's had done a brand new print. And I was able to tell the audience that I was watching the movie complete for the first, with an audience, or even by myself for the first time in 32 years. And it was a wonderful experience. It was very strangely affecting, because it was a kind of time travel. But I haven't gone back and watched any of my movies once they're done. And I think a lot of filmmakers like that, because once they're done, they're done. There's nothing else you can do. And it's basically left, in a sense, for the audiences to tell you what you've got. So I'm in that phase now where I'm slowly discovering what we've done, trying to understand what it is.
Well, there was a period where you were kind of stuck here a little bit, that Witches of Eastwick period, where it was kind of like you were a Hollywood director for a moment, it seemed like.
Well, Witches of Eastwick cured me of that, because I had a wonderful time with Jack Nicholson, who still is a great sage to me. I learned more from him than from anybody else. He's an extraordinary human being. But apart from that, it was a kind of... I went from the Twilight Zone working with like-minded people like, Steven Spielberg and Joe Dante and Frank and Kathy, Frank Marshall and Kathy Kennedy. They were like filmmaking fraternity. Mm-hmm. But then I went into a worst-case scenario with... the Goober Peters and dysfunctional studio, and brought out the worst in me as a filmmaker. Jack kept me in it. I was happy to leave the film when it wasn't about filmmaking. I don't even know what it was. I don't know. I couldn't even understand the chaos that was going on, and so I went straight back and I produced Dead Calm, the film that Phil Noyce made. It didn't make sense to stay in Hollywood. It's where at that time you were not only punished for good behavior, you were rewarded for bad behavior. People mistook politeness for weakness, but so the more badly I behaved, more attention I got. It was like
so. You have some responsibility for the unpleasantness in that experience. No. The stories are kind of like not specific, but very mean.
Well. For instance, I didn't realize at the time that they, in one of the first meetings, they're looking to cut the budget, and I said, "Well, look, I don't need a trailer." Because I'm never in my trailer. I'm always on the set or in someone else's trailer talking to the actors. Now, having made low budget movies and basically produced my own movies, I thought that was a good thing, and saved money. But that meant to them that this guy is negotiable on everything. Mm-hmm. So when I turned up and I needed 150 extras in one scene, 75 turned up. So I thought, what's going on here? And when I asked for a big wind machine, they gave me a small wind machine, and we couldn't shoot.
Mm.
And we couldn't shoot. So then I said, okay, I'll order 300 extras. And they'd say, well, we can't fit them in.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say, well, last time you said, you know, and so on and so on. How many camera crews do you want today? I'd over-order camera crews and so on, because it was a kind of a pushback.
Mm-hmm.
And then you start enjoying the pushback, and then you start saying, well, unless John Peters is off the set, I'm not turning up to shoot, and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then suddenly everyone's paying attention to you. So it was not a good thing. And I remember in the sound, when we were doing sound, there's a wonderful sound editor who came up to me and he said, just be careful, George. He said, I work with Sam Peckinpah.
Mm.
And he said, at the end, Sam was making movies to shove it to them. He said, don't fall into that trap. Mm. Don't lose the joy in filmmaking. And they were really important words to me, because I'd lost my curiosity for filmmaking.
Mm.
And that was a worst case scenario. I'm not saying it's like that all the time, but it didn't make any sense to stick around. Plus, nowadays you can make films from everywhere. It was just on the cusp of that thing where people are completely agnostic as to where you're going to make the movie, and you can go down to Wellington, New Zealand, a city of 400,000 people, and you've got the greatest filmmaking community in the world. And that's why Jim Cameron's down there. That's why Steven Spielberg's there. And I learned from those guys, you could just video conferencing.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. You've got these little, you know, you've got Austin, Texas, where there's a great filmmaking community, and so on around the world. So those days have gone now.
Well, I met you about 8 years ago, 9 years ago, and I knew those stories from back in the day, and there was, you know, you kind of this weird reputation with some people, and some people had nasty things to say. And I was like, you always seemed, from the first time I ever met you, to be one of the sweetest people in the world. So I never could connect those two things.
Yeah.
You know, you seemed to have such a joy in the work that the idea that there was this, you know, ugly moment was almost unbelievable. But
yeah. Yeah, well, that's going to appreciate. You always get the best work when you're relaxed and there's good grace and nobody loses their dignity. Mm. And it's a kind of sport, and the great sportsmen have that amazing ability to be relaxed in those big clutch moments, you know? And I think that's the same with actors and crew and cameramen or whatever. I don't know how people can direct in a tyrannical way, because you're not availing yourself, you're not harnessing for the film all that wonderful creative energy that people have. All they're relying on you, the director, is to be a very strong guide as to where we're going. So, that's why, to be honest, in a demented sort of way, I still find a pleasure in film. I mean, even when it's really tough, like Fury Road, in a physical way, there is a kind of pleasure putting it all together.
Great. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, David. Yeah.